Now, last thing I really want to bring up is supplements. 86% of games athletes take supplements. 86%. Surprised by that? No, not at all. Me neither. Okay, but here's the funny part. There is no rhyme or reason behind those 86% what they're taking. Anything from liquid greens to a laundry list of performance-enhancing stuff. Creatine, microlactin, beta-alanine, you name it. What is our recommendation? What's my recommendation? Start with the simple stuff. What's the big one? Fish oil, you guys know it. Fish oil. Now, we typically say for the person that's just getting into CrossFit that 3 grams will do and add from there. For the amount of damage that you guys are doing towards your muscle, I say that a minimum of 10 grams of EPA, DHA, when you're training at a higher volume. See how you feel. How do we judge it? It's gonna sound nasty, but if you leave an oil spill in the toilet, we've got an issue. Okay? But it's real. Now, the second thing is vitamin C. Vitamin C is an antioxidant. Okay? It helps break up the process of free radicals around the body that are caused by the stimulus of exercise. Every one of us should be taking anywhere from starting at 1,000 milligrams to topping out somewhere around 2,000 milligrams. Vitamin D. Studies have shown that every American, on average, is deficient in vitamin D. Essential for cardiac health. We use our hearts very hard. We damage the hell out of it. You guys experience on a very constant basis. So vitamin D, how much do we take? Up to 5,000 IU per day during the months which you are not exposed to the sunlight. Okay, for those of you lucky enough to live in Southern California, this is less necessary. Okay, simply going outside and exposing 40% of your body to sunlight for 20 minutes a day, you will get about 5,000 IU. Your body can synthesize that. All right. And then lastly, creatine. Now this one comes with a little caveat that continued use of creatine without taking breaks from using it has shown to cause kidney damage. So if you're gonna use it, number one, have your blood levels checked. See what your kidneys are doing, see how they're working. Now with that said, it's also shown to extend the period of our phosphocreatine performance. So we'll see better lifts, better single effort or five rep max lifts. Five pulls on a rower to see where we're at for our max watts and five pulls, stuff like that. We can see improved performance. Does it do much for us in the longer duration stuff? Not as much. So what does it really do for CrossFitters? It'll help us train to lift heavier weights or do a faster 40. Okay? Questions?
Yeah. On that vitamin C, does it matter? Like, you know, I guess there's pills, powders, I mean, what?
Pills, powders.
What do you suggest? Does it matter?
Usually a liquid form, a liquid form is usually gonna be better synthesized in your body. With that said, I take pills. More convenient, easy to travel with.
How much creatine?
How much creatine? That deviates per person and per package, different brands, stuff like that. I believe, you'll have to check the back of it, but I believe it's 2.5 grams pre and post. Other questions?
On your energy and recovery ratios for protein and carbohydrate, when do you start going up to the upper limits of that? Like, when would you increase based on the duration of the log? I'm assuming, and what would you say, over 15 minutes, over 20 minutes?
Oh, as far as...
So when you had like 0.4 to 0.8 kilograms per body with carbohydrate, 0.2 to 0.4 kilograms?
Yeah, great question. So deviating off the post-workout meal, where we were talking about the 0.2 to 0.4 for protein, and what was it, 0.4 to 0.8 for carbs? Okay, so workout length can dictate what levels we want. Workout demand can dictate as well. Okay, something like Fran. All right, something like triple Fran. Where it's much more demanding, where you're expecting a very, because of the stimulus, a very bad response. Extremely sore legs, extremely damaged muscle tissues. We're gonna have a higher demand for recovery.
So are you basing that demand off of caloric expenditure, or are you basing it off of, well, I guess that would be the only thing that you would base it off of, right?
Well, caloric expenditure, but also the muscle tissue breakdown is another big part of it. The amount of damage you do to your muscle tissue, we're gonna need to take more protein in to help recover from that. And also, the amount of energy expenditure can help us recover some of that glycogen if we increase our carbohydrate levels. But again, you're gonna have to figure out those numbers so that we don't deviate too far off that baseline 25 blocks. Now with that said, guys, I mean, the 25 blocks or the, you know, whatever your training baseline is, you deviate that however you need to so that you feel good. You can drop 2 blocks of carbs per day, you can add in an extra block of protein. I mean, Pat's a perfect example. He's played with it for 5 years now and gone all over the place. Comes back to baseline, changes it again. Puts on 5 pounds, changes it again. Drops 5 pounds, changes it again. Questions?
What's the lowest the CrossFitter wanted to work out today? You know, like on that 18 blocks, let's say, you know, and they wanted to drop a body weight, you know, as low as a half carb? You know, where have you seen that kind of like you're in dangerous waters?
Right. Well, I the question is how low to go with the carbs? And we've seen people try to put this on fast forward where they're like, okay, yeah, I've got a lot of fluff from a rough winter of holidays, right? I'm gonna go zero carbs for the next month and only have carbohydrates post-workout because that's when I can replenish my glycogen stores and so on and so forth. They can go on that road for a while, but without a doubt, I'm talking complete elimination of carbohydrates, except for post-workout where they backload some of the carbohydrates. We can see people continue along on that road for a period of time, but eventually, usually around the 2 week mark, tank. You see it in their performance. You see their Fran add a minute. You see their longer duration efforts add way more time or fewer rounds. And that's where we need to say, okay, we need to go back to baseline. We know it works for you. We know it. This is obviously not working for you. You may have eliminated a little fluff. That's great, but let's go back to that baseline so we can recover performance. There is that fine balancing act, and we've all experienced it. Tommy, you experienced it last year. You drop weight, we affect performance. We add weight, we affect performance. We need to know where baseline is.
Matt, how would you or would you modify this for masters athletes or people over 45, 50 years old?
I would not. The question is the masters athletes, people who are a little older, age deviations. Remember, what we're primarily concerned about is this right here. Lean body mass. If they've got it, we support it. Protein, and then we fill in the blanks after that. There's our prescription.
Do you tweak it in any consistent way differently for female clients?
For what kind of clients?
Female clients.
No, again, I mean, it comes down to this same thing that Justin just asked. Male, female, young, old, children, you know, teens, stuff like that are interested in competing, I would not assign this to them. I would balance their macronutrients. I'd make sure that they have proteins, carbs, and fats at every single meal. They understand what a post-workout meal is. I would not weigh and measure. I'd allow them to eat as much as they want as long as they're seeing optimal performance, optimal recovery. But for male, female, young, and old, we are most concerned about game day. And if we don't know what this is, we can't deviate off it to see how we operate. Once we've tested and we've played with those numbers, boom, there it is. There's my sweet spot. I'm money there. I know I don't need to worry about my nutrition. I can operate at a very high level with that training prescription that I've established. I've practiced it. I know what it is. Okay, you're not looking to lose weight during the CrossFit Games. right? Maybe for the CrossFit Games, but not at the CrossFit Games.
Can you talk a little bit about hydration?
Yeah. So hydration is a huge part, plays a huge part in your recovery. Huge part. If you wake up in the morning 4 pounds lighter and your urine is dark yellow, you're affecting your recovery. Okay? There's a lot of things that we look at with recovery, but hydration is going to be one of the biggest. Sleep, hydration. Okay? And what I would start to measure if I were you guys is I would wake up in the morning, jump on a scale, see where you're at day to day to day to day. If you lost 4 pounds from yesterday to today and you only did one workout, what's the deviation? It's not this, right? The caloric intake is exactly the same. We're not deviating off of that, so that's not the issue. If I lost 4 pounds, I'm down a half gallon of water. Half gallon of blood volume, half gallon of recovery, and I get off the scale, 4 pounds lighter, go take a pee. Ah, yeah, well, it looks like Coca-Cola. Okay, and that truly affects your recovery.
Do you have specific guidelines that you would recommend?
Yeah, so typically for it's area specific, kind of like the damper setting on a rower, it's area specific. Tommy is gonna have to drink much more water than the Valley Girls do. Right? They're at a lower elevation. When they breathe in and out, there's more moisture in the air. So they're actually taking some moisture in, breathing some out. Whereas Tommy and I, at a higher elevation, Chris, Eric, at a higher elevation, when we exhale, we're exhaling a lot of moisture into a very dry climate. So it's going to change from person to person. But again, you need to establish what works well for you. You can overhydrate and affect your recovery because you stay up peeing all night. You can underhydrate, we know that. So you need to kind of establish how much water works well for you. I know that for me, 100 ounces of water works very well at this higher elevation. Okay, now here's the other thing. Just simply hammering down water on a daily basis, not the greatest thing, right? We're washing out our electrolytes, which will affect our performance, especially with this clean diet. We don't have a lot of salt in our diet, and all of a sudden you're gonna start to notice, hey, I'm drinking like crazy, but geez, I feel like I'm dehydrated. Let's add in some of those electrolyte salts. Okay, there's a million different brands of effervescent tablets that you can crack open and put inside your water now that will give you those salts that you need. Magnesium, chloride, all that stuff. Does that help? Other questions? Good.
So like the types of food on a competition day.
Yeah.
I know our guidelines is meats and vegetables, stuff to eat, some fruit, little stuff, no sugar. But is there some foods we should stay away from or gravitate to on competition day?
I would say that the question is competition day, carbohydrates mostly, right? Yeah. I would say that it's probably more fair to stay with a little bit of veggies and probably more fruit. Okay, the issue is you're not filling your belly with as much volume, which we don't want to do. Okay, but at the same time, we're still packing in the same amount of carbohydrate, mostly in the form of fructose when we have that fruit, which is not synthesized in your muscle fibers, but it is synthesized mostly in your liver. So in other words, eating a ton of fruit post-workout is not an optimal choice because when we eat that fruit, we're eating a lot of fructose. Yeah, there is sucrose in it for sure, but again, it's about 50% on most fruits of fructose. So it's not the most optimal choices because it doesn't help replenish our muscle glycogen stores. So despite having a huge meal of fruits, you may still feel like you're lacking the energy when you actually get out there. Your muscles die out quickly. So with that said, I would think that more dense starches, sweet potatoes, are an optimal choice because that is almost entirely sucrose.
Coconut water.
Maltodextrin. Yep. Questions?
I've got an athlete that suffers with cramping. Do you have any suggestions? Particularly during workouts.
Cramping. Okay, well, first thing I would look at is hydration. And then I would ask the question, if it was at this elevation, how much water are you drinking? And is it only water? Okay, and if the answer is yeah, I only drink water, I say, tell me a little bit about your diet. Do you add salt in any of your workouts? No, I'm salt-free completely. Don't touch it. Any processed foods that you might get salt into your diet? No, complete. I just pack in the veggies and all that stuff, and I cook all my food on my own. Okay, then I would look at those hydrating salt. Let's try this. Let's see if it makes an affects a change at all.
So primarily just a sodium question.
It would be. Yep. It would be.
Just one, just from experience, like as far as gaining and losing, as important as nutrition sometimes is just a stimulus. So especially with like high school kids that are having a really tough time gaining weight, I've just noticed through experience, you may have found the same thing, like doing a bunch of Metcons and stuff is not a good stimulus to get bigger.
Right.
It's okay. But they're definitely I feel like the programming bias has as much an impact. Like if you're really lean and squatting four times a week, you're going to have a hard time losing.
Right.
And on that same token, if you're doing a bunch of Metcons and eat a bunch of food, you're going to have a hard time gaining. Like, I'm sure Chris has noticed it. Like Chris had to add a ton of just volume training, lifting and stuff like that. So right. That's a whole other topic, but
it is. No, but it's like a great point to say.
Stimulus is almost has to be considered with the nutrition.
Absolutely. When we run into that issue where we're not loading the body up as much as we would if we were working specifically on strength, when we're trying to gain weight, the more you load your central nervous system, the more your body responds by growing. If we're doing 95-pound thrusters for 100 reps, obviously we're not going to give the body the same stimulus. So when we have that 30 blocks of food, 5x fat, and we're trying to reach a goal of weight, scale back the Metcons. Scale back the Metcons, load the central nervous system. Yoke carries, mandatory, 2 minutes a day. Stuff like that. Absolutely, without a doubt. Guys, I'm gonna give it to Chris.
Thanks, man.
Yeah, I guess.